I have selected as the title of my remarks tonight, The President and the Press. Some may suggest that this would be more naturally worded, The President versus the Press, but those are not my sentiments tonight. This nation's foes have openly boasted of acquiring through our newspapers information they would otherwise hire agents to acquire through theft, bribery, or espionage. The newspapers which printed these stories were loyal, patriotic, responsible, and well-meaning. Had we been engaged in open warfare, they undoubtedly would not have published such items. But in the absence of open warfare, they recognized only the tests of journalism and not the tests of national security. Every newspaper now asks itself, with respect to every story, is it news? All I suggest is that you add the question, is it in the interest of national security? No president should fear public scrutiny of his program, for from that scrutiny comes understanding, and from that understanding comes support or opposition, and both are necessary. I am not asking your newspapers to support an administration, but I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people. And so it is to the printing press, to the recorder of man's deeds, the keeper of his conscience, the courier of his news, that we look for strength and assistance, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent.
We are so pleased to be the host venue for an exhilarating examination of the past 50 years of news reporting and covering tragedy. The sequence of events that took place in Dallas in November in the aftermath of President Kennedy's assassination have had profound meaning and impact on our local community, not just that of the nation and on the world. I'm sure if President Kennedy were looking down upon us, he would surely be pleased that to know that even after the 50th anniversary commemorative programming in 2013, that his life and legacy is being remembered and made relevant with the creative production of an opera in his honor. We at the Sixth Floor Museum have really enjoyed the opportunity working with the Fort Worth Opera over the last year, and particularly with our longtime colleagues at KERA, as together we extend our community outreach across the DFW area to provide a wide range of stimulating discussions about aspects of our local history, how we record, interpret, and present our shared history, and dynamic and relevant aspects of Kennedy's legacy. Our cultural community across North Texas is being made much richer and more meaningful and salient as we build these sorts of organizational collaborations. And I look forward to all of us continuing to explore new ways and means of strengthening our work together. On behalf of our team and our board at the Sixth Floor Museum, thank you to the Fort Worth Opera and to KERA, our dear friends. And please now join me in welcoming Darren Woods, director of the Fort Worth Opera.
Thank you. Wow, you're taller than me. As many of you know, these symposia were born out of two of our staff members who were traveling back from New York City, and they saw the trials in Ferguson, and they said, I wonder what President Kennedy would have to say about that. So at the very next staff meeting, we brainstormed about having talks across the Metroplex about different things, space race, civil rights, Cuba, journalism, and then lastly, next month, the arts and architecture, things that Kennedy was talking about and things that we're still wrestling with today. We are thrilled that KERA was the first group of people we went to. I called Marianne Al-Hadif and said, we've got to have a meeting, and they signed on immediately. So we've been really looking forward to this. I would like to thank not only KERA and the Sixth Floor Museum, but this was made possible by a generous grant from Opera America and the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. And we are selling opera tickets over there, so if you want to get your ticket tonight, this is the time to do it. I'd like to introduce our host and moderator tonight. She's no stranger to any of us in this room. Krys Boyd has been host and managing editor at KERA-FM's flagship midday talk show, Think, my favorite show on any radio, since 2006. Krys began her career along the U.S.-Mexico border, working simultaneously at radio and television stations as a reporter, anchor, and news director. A graduate of TCU, Krys returned to North Texas in 1999 to serve as news director for Broadcast.com and later senior producer of Broadcast News at Yahoo. Krys joined KERA in 2001, hosting the nightly radio talk show Conversations. Later, she wrote and produced documentary and educational television programs, including the critically acclaimed nationally broadcast JFK, Breaking the News in 2003, and served as producer and co-host of the Emmy Award-winning public affairs program On the Record. Think was named Best Radio Talk Show of Dallas by the Dallas Observer in 2009, and Krys was declared Best Broadcaster of Radio in Dallas by D Magazine in 2010, and won the Prindy Award for Best Call-In Program in 2012. Krys and her husband, Matt, live in Dallas and have four children. Please welcome the amazing Krys Boyd.
I want to get straight to the conversation. So we will bring them out now. We have, first sitting next to me, we have John McCaa, who is anchor at WFAA and really needs no introduction. And Dr. Seema Yasmin is a staff writer at the Dallas Morning News and public health professor at the University of Texas at Dallas. And Wade Goodwin is national correspondent for NPR. Everyone, make yourselves comfortable. So it's really interesting that we're here at the Sixth Floor Museum because we learned as a society with the assassination of President Kennedy that this experimental medium at the time, broadcast television, radio had been around for a while, could really unite the country and the world in simultaneously experiencing this thing that happened here in our city. And John, I know that you have a memory of this from very far away.
My dad was in the military, so we lived in Spain, right outside of Madrid. I was in the fourth grade, and so it was nighttime there. And the interesting thing is, I can remember our neighbor, Mrs. Attaway, coming to the back door, banging on the door. And I remember her and my mother crying. Also, again, this is a military base, Torrejon Air Base. And I remember looking out the front window. And at the end of every one of these streets we lived on, the streets in this area, there was a blue light that would flash anytime there was an alert. And I remember seeing that blue light flashing, seeing grown-ups dressed in their flight uniforms, going to the runway, the flight line, because there was some concern that this might be some kind of an attack on the United States. So there was those initial moments, real fear that this was the start of a very serious problem and possibly even war.
Were you thinking about journalism back then, in fourth grade?
In the fourth grade? No, you know, actually, I began thinking about journalism when we moved to the same place, one house down, when I was in high school. And we had television, but we didn't pay attention to television because Francisco Franco was in charge and we didn't want to watch his television. But we had one radio station. And so it was radio that really made me realize that this is a place where all of us can gather and understand the same information. So that's when I probably started. And that, in fact, had my own little radio show when I was in high school because of that.
What was it called?
That's a good question. It was called Teen Time.
That's why you didn't say it right off. These days, of course, we have myriad sources of instantaneous information. Some of them are highly accurate, and some of them are not so accurate. And we may be, oddly, way more fragmented than we were in the past because there's so much information out there.
Well, I agree, and you know, the idea is that the internet is going to make all our jobs obsolete. So the day is going to come when we'll have one producer of news and 7 million repeaters of the one producer of news. No, I'm kidding, but I mean, I think the role that newspapers and TV stations and radio stations play, I don't see it going away, because professional journalists and what they do is really it's the font from which everything else springs, all of the repetition that goes on. Somebody has to produce that content. And I think that even though there's a growing number of outlets and ways to consume that content, I don't see the producers going away. I think the contraction that we've seen in the newspaper business, I'm hoping, has run its course, and that we're going to start to see. I think we've started to see the Dallas Morning News has begun to retrench and grow again, which I think is a wonderful thing. I don't think the newspaper's out of the woods yet, but I'm hoping the worst is over.
Seema, I'm going to assume, I'll speak for myself, but I think I can speak for my broadcast colleagues as well. You're the only digital native on this stage. And I wonder about how you have, as a younger journalist, seen the integration. Does it feel completely natural to you, the integration of every possible form of media to tell a story?
It does, because I walked into a newsroom with it operating that way. So you don't just file a print story, but you better have an idea about using video. And you better have talked to a good photographer about forming an interactive. And you're going to use Twitter to tweet out your stories a few times a day. And you're going to look for things that are trending on Twitter. And you're going to look for even sources on Twitter. And then you're going to Instagram some pictures about your story. So we really are multimedia, multi-platform journalists. And I think that becomes a really organic, natural way of approaching a story right from the beginning.
It can be challenging when you're searching for all that and you are also trying to write a cogent narrative.
I think that those things can actually inform it, though. When you are spending time with a photographer thinking about an interactive, I mean, we have 13 amazing photojournalists at Dallas Morning News, and you see where they stand in a room when they take a picture, and you see what angle they're looking at, and why do they walk closer at some point, and you think about different aspects of the story and how they see it. And also finding sources. Twitter has helped me enormously, as has Instagram. Myself and one of the Cox reporters, Naomi Martin, went to St. Louis on a very last-minute road trip a few months ago because a young woman had died from illegal buttocks injections. And she was a dancer, and it was really hard to get her family to speak. But Instagram instantly led us to so many of her friends, and we got the story that way.
There are people who assume that journalists live for really tragic stories.
No. I think all of us will probably say the same thing. We got into this business because we were interested in ideas and information and the shaping of information so that a society can understand itself. The tragic stories are tragic and big because they rarely happen. What happened here, which really started television broadcast news the way we even have it today, was just huge. That's why we remember it. It is a mistake, however, I think, to believe that we just wait around for some tragedy to occur. Because I get people all the time who tell me, and I'm sure you've heard the same thing, why don't you do the good news? And I will tell them, well, I will point out stories that we've done, and they'll say, well, I didn't see that. And I said, well, we do those stories. I mean, we really work hard at trying to do those kinds of stories. And I think the technology that you've heard Seema talking about, that allows us to do even more of those stories. But the great tragedy is that people do not remember those kinds of stories because they are not as affected by those stories as they are by a great tragedy.
Are there ways that, I mean, do you have to think when you go into Wade, a situation where people have really experienced trauma, are you aware that they're going to be hypersensitive to your portrayal of their situation, their lives?
Well, each trauma is unique. A school shooting is a story in which the communities almost always are terribly defensive, get terribly defensive pretty quickly. Right around day three, they've had enough of us. And especially in the early days, Paducah and Jonesboro, we were searching for why these young shooters might have done these things. So we lit upon the idea that video games perhaps might be some, you know, contributing factor. But inevitably, the community itself begins to feel like we're casting stones at them, perhaps. Or how did you create these little monsters who have done this thing? A hurricane or tornado is really quite a different kind of tragedy in which there really isn't defensiveness in the community because no one feels like they were to blame for what had happened to them. It was an act of God. So I find that covering those stories, people are very happy to talk to you as they stand amidst what used to be their house. It's heartbreaking for them, kind of, you can see the amazement in their eyes that what has happened to them has actually happened to them. There's almost a sense of disbelief, people get exhausted so quickly. I mean, when you've lost your ability to have electricity, we don't realize covering hurricanes is the worst. Because you go into this place that no longer has electricity, that no longer has running water. Without electricity, you can't pump gas into your car. It's hot. It's like Vietnam, because it's always in the summertime. You're always in a t-shirt and shorts trying to type something out because you're staying in some hotel that's been shattered. And I remember in Hurricane Rita, we were staying at the Holiday Inn in Port Arthur. I called it the Holiday Inn from Hell. And all of the downstairs glass had been shattered by the hurricane. The lobby floor was a mess of broken glass, and every time you stepped in it, the water would squish up. And I guess when the electricity turned off, all the little air conditioners in the room dumped the water into the carpet. So you would wear your shoes when you're in your room because it was so gross. And it's days and days and days. I mean, it's kind of where the reporter and the victims kind of merge into one miserable experience. And you really do feel what they're going through because you have to go through it too. Luckily, we haven't had hurricanes hit Texas in a while. And every summer that goes by that we don't, I say a little prayer of thanks. But so I guess the point is, not all tragedies are created equal in terms of covering them and the difficulty. And a lot of that has to do with the way the victims respond to your entreaties to have them tell their story.
And don't get us wrong. I mean, there are certainly those reporters who aren't understanding what these people have gone through. Reporters who say, well, your child was just killed. So what's going through your mind right now? Well, my child just died. I mean, that's a dumb question to ask. What probably is a better question is to ask them, are you okay? Because at that point, what you'll probably hear from them is, I went through 19 hours of labor for that child. There are ways to do what we do and to tell people about tragedies, but you have to have, it takes a really deft touch to do this, number one. Number two, if you are a journalist who doesn't want to feel these stories, quite frankly, I think the three of us are going to tell you, we don't want you in this business. Because if that's who you are, then people really do not matter. And whether you're talking about the radio, you're talking about digital, or you're talking about newspaper, you're talking about television, every one of these every media wants to tell a story about people. That's what people care about the most, is other people. How are other people doing? So to be in this business, you really have to be very careful on how you tell your stories.
When the tragedy involves violence, where is the balance between focus on the victim and focus on the aggressor?
Well, everyone wants to know who did this. Yeah. And there are sometimes cries that we are spending too much time focusing on who did this and why, and not enough time focusing on the victims that had the violence perpetrated upon them. I think there's a rhythm to the story, and the rhythm is, who did this and why did they do it? And once we start to get a handle on that, then I think we want to turn our attention to, what has been the consequences of this horrible act? And so that we take people through, the balance has to be, people want to hear about the victims, but I worry about this whole voyeur dynamic that here I am mucking about in your misery. And so I'm very reticent and very careful that if you tell me to go away, I go away fast. And I'll push back against NPR, who might want me to interview the wife of the murdered man or whatever it is. I mean, people need some space. And some people do want to talk about what's happened to them, and that's fine. But other people are living their worst nightmare come true. And unless you're there, you have no idea the kind of, they're never going to be okay again after things like these things happen. I mean, they'll put their life back together the best they can and soldier on, but things will never be the same. When I try to tell these stories, I try to do as light a touch as I possibly can. And mostly, I just let them speak for themselves and try to keep myself out of it.
We had this very discussion in the Dallas Morning News just a few days ago, because I'm sure you're all familiar with a very, very tragic story of a young woman, a student, who was murdered, I think, shortly after the new year. And two of my colleagues, Dave Tarrant and Naomi Martin, wrote this amazing, very lengthy narrative intertwining the story of this young woman who was murdered by a young man, and the fact that they had very different lives, but they met at this one awful point. And in terms of metrics, which of course in newsrooms we look at now, the story got an amazing number of hits. People stayed on the story for an average of 6.5 minutes, which is by newspaper standards a very long time. But there were very mixed feelings from our readers about, well, how dare you intertwine the stories of the aggressor and the story of the victim? But yet it was it almost felt like quite a natural way to tell that story. Like, here's the point where they met.
There's also, Seema, I'm very interested in the work that you've done with medical emergencies. And we've talked multiple times about the Ebola outbreak overseas and also the cases of Ebola that happened here. And it was really important to you to keep perspective on the magnitude of the problem here as compared within West Africa.
I remember reporting live for a national, it may have been an international news network, was TV, from Dallas, once we'd had that case of Ebola confirmed here, and then sadly transmission to one of our local nurses. And as the anchor transitioned to me, they said, reporting live from ground zero in Dallas. And I thought, ground zero of what? At the time, there had been about 6,000 people who had died from Ebola in West Africa. And it was very sad that in Dallas, we had one gentleman who did pass away. But I thought, we have lost perspective here. When we have thousands of deaths over here, and we're calling this ground zero. So I quickly took it back to, well, let's remember, this epidemic is garnering lots of attention now because we have a handful of Americans who are infected, and Europeans too. But the real tragedy is in Liberia, Guinea, and Sierra Leone, where this virus is still spreading. That's ground zero.
What do you do when your audience is seeing it as ground zero, and you have other information that you want to communicate, and you want to respect the fears of the people that you're serving, but you recognize that they may be out of proportion?
Well, if we're talking about this as breaking news, which means unedited news, so you're at your position, and you're giving people essentially a narrative that you're bringing along without any kind of edit whatsoever. You have to listen to yourself and you have to listen to the audience. And if people are, if you hear someone say ground zero, you have to ask, is that a fair assessment? I mean, to call us ground zero, this is probably death number 6,700 and so on, the rest of which happened before we got here. So there are certainly ways to do that, and particularly if you are doing this live, if you're doing this as breaking news, you have to take control of the narrative, because you are essentially weaving information for the viewer, for the reader, for the listener, as you're going along. So it's okay to interject. It's okay to ask questions. But if you know information is not correct, we've chatted about this a lot. It is much easier to not report something you're not sure of than to report some information, find out that it's false, and then have to go back and fix it. Because once it's out of the, you know, once it's out, and you've got to spend a lot of time trying to fix. No, that wasn't true. We told you this 15 minutes ago. That's not correct. You have to do that more than once. I don't want to do that. And so I think the thing that we see coming along is that because technology has allowed us to be faster with what's happened, you really, I would much rather be right than first. And I think that we're slowly but surely starting to realize that if you're wrong, you could be toast.
Well, inside NPR, we've been working hard on this. And I think in the beginning of my career there, it was much more haphazard, the way we would confirm whether something that we had that no one else had was actually true or not. After we made the mistake with the Congressman Gabby Giffords, I don't know if everybody here knows what we did, but we reported that the Congresswoman had died when the Congresswoman had not died. And it was terribly traumatic for everybody. I was not part of the reporting team on the ground at that time, but the family heard, was listening to NPR. And so you can imagine how everybody felt. And that, I think, made us, we now have what we call a standards editor, who is on call, or someone who's on, who's there, who's gonna help us decide and make the final call about whether or not we're gonna report something. And usually, you know, our rule is we have to have two other confirming sources. They don't have to be on the record sources, but they have to confirm what we've got. And so that's what we work for. It's hard, especially when you've got something that no one else has. I beg for just one more confirming source. Just let me have one more. And sometimes they'll say, okay. But the whole Gabby Giffords thing taught us that we needed to have institutionalized inside the news network in DC a way that we made these calls. And so now we do. And but you know, I think like the Ebola story. Let me just go back to that. The way to integrate for me is to bring that backstory to light. I mean, that's how you explain how Dallas became Ground Zero. I mean, it was this young man who was really a hero, who helped a neighbor take care of his very sick daughter and take her to the hospital in a taxi. And she was pregnant, and she was terribly ill with Ebola. He knew it. And he went and helped them get her into that cab. They took her to the hospital. The hospital said, no, no, we are full. Take her home. They got her back into the cab and took her home. And I think the next day he got on an airplane. And he could have said, you know what? I'm starting a brand new life in the United States. I wish I could help you, but I can't. But that's not what it means to be a neighbor. And he got in that taxi and helped them with that woman, and it cost him his life. And that's a great story. And it helped, I think, Dallas come to grips with the idea that this person was not a disease carrier. He was much more than that. And you know, we learned, we shut this family up in their own little apartment for day after day after day, until finally we were shamed that we had treated them so shabbily. The county judge who kind of swooped in and acted Clay Jenkins, and you know, went into the house and said, "We're going to help you," and they've, you know, took them to a place where the church had provided for them. And but it was interesting to watch New Jersey kind of repeat Dallas's mistakes with that nurse. You know, we kind of had to learn that these were people who needed our help, and they were not contagion. Because at first we treated them like they were contagion, and they were like, "Oh, okay, we're sorry. Let us help you." But it took us a while to get there, several days.
And in that case, it wasn't reporters who were misreporting the news. It was a governor who was saying that Casey Hickox, the nurse who went to volunteer in Sierra Leone and with children with Ebola, that she had symptoms, and she didn't. So then there was the whole correcting that narrative that he's saying one thing, and we were interviewing her directly because I used to work with her at the CDC, and she said she didn't have any of these symptoms. So there was that correction going on as well.
And try to convince a politician to come in front of a camera and say that I gave you some misinformation under those circumstances. And to be quite honest with you, I mean, that is when you have to make them say that. Because if you want to lead, then you should lead. And you have to be, fear is a dangerous thing. We all know fear is a very dangerous thing. And so what you have to do under some circumstances like this, you have to take on a role as a journalist that also tries to make sure that you can snuff out as many fires as possible. And that, with Ebola, is what many of us, I think, had to do. We had to tell people, look, this, we're not telling you we know everything about this. We don't. But the things that we do know that we can confirm, we'll tell you. And we'll try to move this along and get it to you as quickly as possible. But
we were learning along with everybody
exactly.
else. I mean, putting the family, keeping them isolated, seemed the right thing to do at first. Until we were like, the laundry's piling up, there they are, desperate and alone. And, you know, we're like, oh, maybe this isn't the right tact here. But that wasn't immediately apparent to any of us either at the beginning. So, you know, and I think that can be part of the reporting too, is bringing your own experience of learning about this into the reporting, I think is helpful. Because it, as you learn, so does your audience.
So all of us on this stage would like to think that people stop everything and listen very carefully to what we have to say, or read very carefully. And you know, we all know that people hear snippets of things, and the work that you do is really informing the opinions that people draw very quickly. It seems to me a lot of journalists wait to sort of come to even a personal opinion because you recognize that there's always a lot more information than you were able to get at first pass. People who consume your work may not recognize that. How much do you have to think about the perception of things, even if you're giving out facts that are correct, recognizing that people may perceive a narrative that is not, in fact, accurate?
Well, the good news about technology is it gives you more information quickly. The bad news about technology is it gives you bad information quickly, and it spreads quickly.
It's not labeled bad
information.
And
it's not labeled as bad information. And sometimes it comes from people who otherwise might be reliable sources of information. So we have to fight that. Because you have to fight that not just one day, not just one newscast, not just one story. You have to fight that with several stories. And so that is a new menace, which I think all of us have had to deal with. Every day, when I go in tomorrow, there will be email from someone that I will get that will tell me some information that I know 2 or 3 years ago was proven to be not true. But on Twitter or Facebook or somewhere or some kind of way, they found some information and, you know, I trust this guy. But no matter how much you tell them, it's not going to be true. But you have to. Things that you know not to be true, you have to challenge them, I think, right away.
Well, we become more polarized politically.
Yeah.
And so I'll do a story that has nothing to do with politics, you know, a story about a new musical, you know, or something the Dallas Symphony is doing, and the comments section will devolve into this nasty fight over Obama.
That's true.
I'm like, hey, there's nothing about politics in here. But so for me, how things are perceived is something that's in my head all the time. At a certain point, you can be your worst censor, your own censor. At some point, you got to let it go and tell the story the best way you can. And whatever names you're called is the names you're going to be called. And that's that. You know, it's the world we live in now. But things have gotten so polarized that almost any work I do is viewed through a political lens. It's just the world we live in. I don't think there's any way to stop it. But I certainly do carefully parse my language when I'm covering, especially if I'm covering a political story that is, you know, full of weight, then you're going to know people are going to be very affected by one way or the other.
Are you more likely to self-censor if you are aware that you actually do have a strong opinion about something?
No. No, I keep my opinions, I'm not trying to lobby, I guess, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. To try to keep your own way of seeing out of a piece, it's impossible. Yeah, I mean, you can only be who you are, and, you know, who you are as a journalist is how you've come to see the whole world. And so the idea that you can somehow remove that part of yourself from your reporting, if you do, it's not going to be very good. It's going to be just the facts, ma'am. It's not going to move anybody to care. So I think you have to put yourself in the piece, but, you know, do so in a way that's just honest and upfront. If you explain to your audience why you think what you think, why the piece is this way, people will go with you. But you have to respect them enough to explain how it was that you came to see this way. And you put that in the story, and I think that's helpful.
John and Seema, what's your perspective on the use of emotion as a tool of journalism?
One of the ways you can put emotion into a story, well, you can, people that are cry, the questions that you ask, also music, those are methods that are used to put emotion into a story. The question is it warranted? Is it being used just for emotion itself, or is it something that's necessary to fully tell a complete story or to give a complete picture of an individual or an event? If it is that, I understand that. If it's just something to heighten the feeling of someone, well, then you've got to ask yourself some hard questions. Is this really necessary? Is this fair? Music is very subtle. A lot of people don't realize the power that music can have with regard to a story. So you have to be very careful with the use. You probably have rules at NPR about the use of music. I mean, we try to have very careful rules about that. But words and the use of emotion, you have to be careful. You certainly don't want someone to talk about a tragedy and to talk about it as if it's, you know, Jack Webb on Dragnet or something like that. But you want someone who feels strongly about something. But would you say it's a 10-minute interview and there's 7 seconds of them crying? Would you use just the 7 seconds? Well, then I think you're going to have to take a look at what you're doing and what it is that you're trying to bring across to an audience.
What makes me very anxious is what questions I might have to ask somebody who's been through a tragedy, whether it's recent or old, that would help me understand what they are feeling now and what they were feeling then. We know from so many psychiatric and psychological studies that asking those kinds of difficult, deep delving questions can trigger things in people, and it can be really, really dangerous, actually. And I'm relatively new to journalism, coming from a medical background and medical research, and any time that I would be doing a study that involved humans, that involved talking to them about trauma, I would have to have a survey, a questionnaire that's been vetted by multiple people at multiple levels and gone by ethicists and institutional review boards. So now, I just came back from Liberia over the Christmas holidays, and I was reporting on post-Ebola syndrome and the lives of Ebola survivors. And I was in the largest slum in Liberia talking to 14, 15, and 16-year-old girls who were raped during the Ebola epidemic because there were quarantines, there was this tension, and so there was an increase in the number of girls who were assaulted. And so a part of me is thinking these are very important stories to relay, especially when everyone thinks the tragedy is over, right? Because there are no Ebola cases in America and there are far fewer in West Africa. But a part of me is sitting there in this clinic thinking, no one's vetted my questions. No one's sitting with me. How is this allowed? And I went to journalism school in Canada, and I remember when I was in Toronto, a group of my classmates went to a talk where a very celebrated young Canadian journalist was talking about some work he had done in Kenya. And he had just come back from talking to women who I believe were living with HIV/AIDS, and he had these really powerful images, and he had given the women quite expensive cameras. And the idea was phenomenal. Like, instead of me being a photojournalist and taking your photo, I'm gonna give you the camera, you take the pictures. And as soon as he said that, I thought, oh my gosh, that would never have gone past an IRB. No ethicist would have allowed that. And the next sentence was him saying he was quite upset that women had sold the cameras to buy food. I'm like, well, what did you think would happen? You actually put them at risk of violence by giving them this expensive equipment. So I'm still really shocked and incredulous that I can go somewhere where somebody has just suffered a tragedy and ask them things, and no one's checking about what I'm asking. No one's saying, are you going to offer counseling after this interview, as they would if I was doing some kind of medical research. That still makes me really nervous.
Well, you know, public radio is the brave new world in this. We don't use music at NPR, but they use music in This American Life, which is one of the most influential public radio programs there is out there. And so now we're getting podcasts that are in the This American Lifestyle that don't hesitate to use music underneath. And they're doing serious journalism. There's no question that, you know, podcasts like Serial, and they're doing real reporting. And so the question is, how do you draw the line? Where do you draw the line? Should at NPR, it's still that's a bridge too far. We're not going to use music under our you know, interviews. But there's lots to, that may be going the way of the dinosaur. And so I don't really have an opinion myself. I don't think, the problem is, music lends a certain emotional weight, but which is not bad, it can also be a tiny bit manipulative, or maybe more than a tiny bit manipulative, because if you're hearing a sad story and we're playing sad music, we're communicating that this sadness is should be respected, that it's authentic, that it's real and true, I don't really feel like that's the. I don't have an opinion on it. I guess I listen to This American Life. I like the way they do it, and I hear these podcasts, and I think, ooh, but I'm also a little wary of it.
I don't have a dog in this fight, but how is music different from writing in a certain way that would elevate the emotion in the piece?
Yeah, there isn't any, I think Wade addressed that. There really isn't any way to take all of you out of a story. There are certain words you have to be very careful. I've read stories before where someone will write the word propaganda instead of information, and I say, well, you know, I understand that you think that those are interchangeable, but they are not. They create different values in people. So you have to be careful with that. In terms of your writing, I think after you've been in this business a while, you try to give weight to, if you're doing a story about some controversial subject, you try to give equal weight to both sides. You try to give weight to whatever the science is with regard to it. And if you can see in all of that, everybody's voice heard, I think that's about the best that you can do. The concern I think a lot of people have is that a lot of what we have heard in terms of mainstream media, by that I mean ABC, CBS, NBC, the main cable networks, a lot of what you've heard has come from the same voice, as opposed to having people who, everybody says, oh, you know, they're far out to the right, they're far out to the left. Well, sometimes those people need to be included if you want a total picture of what society is discussing. That, to me, is, if that's what you're after, that's what you have to get.
I'm going to take some questions from the audience momentarily here. The last thing I want to ask you myself is, people who are affected by tragedy that you have to cover are often regular people. They're not people who sought out any kind of fame for themselves, and suddenly, either by an act of their own or by their presence in the wrong place at the wrong time, become figures of national interest. Are there things that your audiences don't have a right to know, that they want to know, that would make for a great lead story?
Well, I think the other way to say that is, are there things that people have told you who are not public figures who you're listening to them say, you know, I don't really think you know what it is that you're telling me. And I will tell you that there have been some stories I have done where I've listened to what the person said, and I've seen that the person is, as Seema has told you, that person is literally broken. And we will not, I won't write that into a story. You can, there are ways to do these stories without destroying a human being. There really are ways to do it. You just have to work at it. And you know, if your excuse is that you're too lazy to work at it, well, trust me, I'm the guy looking to try to get rid of you. I think that all of us will say that. There's a cheap way to do it. It's like anything you do in life. There's a cheap way to do it, and there is a right way to do it. The right way is usually very hard, requires a lot of work, but in the end, you can live with yourself. And that's what I think that's what we want to do, is live with ourselves.
Absolutely, and I think even recently we've seen sad examples of stories where the protagonist or one of the sources in there has committed suicide after the stories come out. Now, we don't know whether that was a direct result of the reporting, but that's certainly on my mind as I write a story. And also just the privilege you have of talking to somebody who's been through something so horrific and is letting you into their home and into their lives or into their clinic and relaying these awful experiences with you. So I will do everything I can to be honest to the story, but really protect that person. Without them, I wouldn't have the story, so I owe that to them.
Ask your question again.
Are there things that your listeners might want to know about a subject, but they don't have the right to know?
I don't know. I think my listeners have the right to know anything that I might find out. I mean, unless my reporting it puts somebody in danger. You know, I told this story earlier. I did a story recently about the impact that the new anti-abortion legislation in Texas has had in not restricting women's access to abortion, but restricting women's access to clinics, just the family planning clinics. 82 family planning clinics have closed in Texas after the most recent, strongest legislation was passed demanding certain kinds of things from the abortion clinics and abortion doctors. And one of the women who was in the piece was a young woman, a student at Texas Tech University, who had met a boy, and she was a junior, and this was going to be her first sexual experience, and she wanted to get birth control. And she went to the student clinic and was treated very shabbily there. It was told she could only have one option and it was gonna take weeks to get. And she said, how come it's gonna take so long? The woman doctor said, boy, you sure are anxious to get started having sex, aren't you? And she was humiliated and furious and walked out and called the county clinic, there was one other, and was told that they could see her in April. It was January. And so she called the Planned Parenthood clinic in Fort Worth and they said, sure, come on down. And she got her birth control and she's praising the Planned Parenthood, kind of, she felt, you know, had this huge, she said, saved my life. Now, she didn't really mean it, but she said, thank goodness I don't have to worry about getting pregnant. And she didn't want her name used. And we have very strict guidelines when someone can be anonymous. Either they can only be anonymous if they feel for their life or they fear for their livelihood. And I said, well, you've got to say your name. I can't. And she said, well, then I'm not gonna be on. So I started to dig deeper. And she said, why won't you let me use your name? And she said, because what happened in Colorado Springs, that guy came into that Planned Parenthood clinic and shot everybody up. And I'm worried that if I am on the radio saying nice things about Planned Parenthood in West Texas, someone might hurt me. And I said, okay. You know, and I took that to the editor, and my editor said, okay, you know. And so she was in the piece. We only used her first name. I think other than information that would endanger somebody, I think my audience has a right to know anything I know.
We're going to take some questions. I see a microphone there. We're going to ask everybody, you might think that we can hear you, and we might be able to, but since we're taping and broadcasting, podcasting, we want to make sure that we can hear you. So please raise your hand and wait till the mic comes to you and ask your question. very fast feet on the mic there.
Thank you. My question is for John. It has to do with national security. The film that we just saw touches a little bit. There's a conflict right now going on between the Obama administration, or maybe the Justice Department, Department of Justice, and Apple. It has to do with the government wants to unlock the phone of the shooter in California, one of the shooters in California. What's your take on that? Would you sign with the government to say this has to do with national security, it's very important in this particular case, or no, the door is closed for everybody else as well?
Well, as a reporter, I don't have an opinion. I think as a reporter, what I would do is I would try to do a story that laid out why the government thought it was important to have the information, and why Apple thought it was important to keep it secret, and why those who are concerned about privacy thought that it was necessary. But as a reporter, I don't. Reporters always like everything to be out in the open. I mean, we certainly do. But having lived, my dad was in the military. Having lived in Spain twice, I do, under Franco, I do understand what it's like to have a government that does not respect your constitutional rights at all, and their desire to have any information on you they possibly can. Other than that, I would try to cover that story as fully as possible in that way. But I would not, not being a member of the government, not being, I got an Apple phone, but other than that, no.
Yeah.
So Krys, you called out the perspective of the victim and the aggressor, but as I pay attention to the news, there's a third element that I'm also interested in, and that is agencies of responsibility. So whether it's a man-made disaster or a global pandemic, I'm interested in state and government responsibilities. I'm interested in the role of the CDC and the WHO. And I'm interested to know, as journalists, how and when do you expand your narrative to include that? And part of the reason I ask is because I think it makes a difference. I think with the Ebola case, certainly the widespread critique of the WHO and the CDC to some extent did make a difference in their response that we're seeing to the Zika virus. So I'm interested to know not just who did it and who was affected, but who might be responsible and how do you cover that?
Well, I think that's one of our main jobs, is to hold institutions accountable. And there's two things go on when something like this happens. There's the breaking news, which is the need to feed the beast every day, the beast being the shows that we are on. But then you have to step back and start to do some investigative reporting and more in-depth reporting. So, you know, at NPR, we organize it so that we have two reporters who don't have daily responsibilities, who are there to advance that story. And advancing that story means taking a look into the government and commercial institutions that have played critical roles in this. The Ebola story was one that was extremely interesting in that, I did this story about how both the government and the hospital's instincts were to blame the nurses. And for whenever we had a mistake, it was the nurses.
Never ever blame nurses.
It was the nurses. It was the nurses who were at fault. And I just put together all these clips, first of the government health organizations, and then the local hospital here, all blaming the nurses for, you know, violating protocol, or they must have made a mistake, or it was all pure speculation on the part of these institutions. And finally, the nurses got pissed. you know, and we had nurse organizations that came out and said, stop it. You know, we are hardly in charge here. We're doing the best we can in an extremely contagious environment. And the truth was the hospital didn't have the best protection equipment. It did have it, actually, but they didn't use it. The nurses asked for it, and the hospital said no. They said, this is what we think is good enough for you, and you'll use that as you clean up the blood and vomit. And they got sick. It wasn't good enough. And we had the health officials in Africa who said, we've been telling you, this is not enough. You guys got to cover up better.
So I agree with you. And certainly our job is to hold agencies and powerful governments and institutions accountable. We don't always do it quickly or early on enough, in my opinion. We waited a long time to do that, to really critique the WHO, especially with the Ebola epidemic. We're starting to do that. I think earlier on with the Zika virus epidemic, NPR has done some fantastic reporting. I think you all have a team that does women's lives or kind of, you know, digs deep on that. And so they've made sure that they've made this a story about women's reproductive health rights and access to contraception, which that's really what this story is about.
And, you know, the Ebola thing was interesting because there was this quiet arrogance that existed in the United States that had to do with, well, you know, it's not going to be a problem here because we're a major hospital. We're not some African backwater. Mm-hmm. And then guess what? It is a problem here. Your workers are getting sick. And so that was quite the wake-up call to the entire country, I think, began to realize that what they thought they had covered, they didn't really have covered.
I'm Ernest Javier. I am a journalism student, and my question is for Mr. Goodwin. Going back to your story about the Planned Parenthood and the girl that went to get the
birth control?
The birth control.
Thing. Yes.
Did you explain to your audience why you protected her identity in your story?
Yes. Yes, I didn't do it right away. I said, we're going to use her first name for reasons we'll explain in a moment. And then I went ahead and told her story. And then we, at the end of it, we talked about her going down to Planned Parenthood and getting what she wanted. And then I said, and this is why she doesn't want her last name used, is because she's afraid that if she's a public supporter of Planned Parenthood, given what happened in Colorado Springs, that she might be a target. So I think you have to explain to your audience why you're keeping somebody's name confidential.
All right, we have time for one final question.
This is for anyone. Do you have any situations where you actually became a part of the story? And if not, how would you handle that situation?
Yeah, so speaking of tragedy, while I was in West Africa reporting on these survivors of Ebola, which was a very tragic story, my family, my mum and my husband are here, and they were so worried about me being in West Africa on my own. I didn't know anybody there. We got hit by the tornado on December 26th. So they were in the house when it happened, and I couldn't get access to them. I didn't know what happened. I thought they had died. And of course, my network here in Dallas is the university and the Dallas Morning News. So I rallied the troops there. And I mean, I could talk for hours about how generous and kind and just wonderful my colleagues were, because they got to the house, they found my family. And so, yeah, I became a part of that story, I felt like. And NBC5, who I do reporting for, went into my house and interviewed my husband. And that was, watching that video clip was one of the first times I really saw what had happened to the house, to be honest. And they mentioned me in it. So that was surreal. And I'm still not sure how I handle that. it's bizarre.
I cannot remember becoming a part of the story, but certainly once that happens, I think you have to disclose that information to the audience in every form and fashion, that your involvement, how you got involved, if you're anything that has to do with you in any position other than being the journalist or observer, you have to tell the audience that right away, so that they can make up their mind about whether or not they want to trust the information that you're going to give them.
I was in Oklahoma City for the bombing, and I'd been there a long time. And, had, you know, it was a very emotional story because so many regular Joes who were just going to their job at the Murrah Federal Building, you know, and the stories were, you know, awful. And so I've been there, I guess, I don't know, weeks and weeks, and it was almost everybody else had gone, and I was there covering the memorial, and they had bagpipes and trumpets. And I had the trumpets in the piece, and I was reading the narration, and I got to the point where I was describing the trumpets, and I burst into tears. Now, I was on tape. I was not live or anything. And I said, all right, you know, I was totally taken by surprise. It, like, came on me and overcame me in a second. And I tried to, I said, wait a minute, you know, give me a second. And I couldn't regain my composure. And I said, you know what, I'm gonna have to call you back. And I called him back 30 minutes later, and I got through it, and I got a phone call. And it was my editor. He said, we're pulling you out. And the technical producers, the sound guys, had gone and said, he's got to go. You know, he's cracking up. And I was.
Well, I mean, he wasn't cracking up, but anybody who thinks that these stories don't get to you, they're lying. When 9/11 happened, you couldn't fly to New York. So we had to drive to New York. And we stayed there for a week, and every day I cried in my hotel room. I mean, every day. Still it bothers me. So we don't want you to think that we're just sitting up here with a paper and pen, you know, just, that's not happening. And if you are trying to make that your life as a journalist, again, you shouldn't be in this business, because you are a human too, and these are humans who've been suffering. And if you cannot share that with other people in a way that's that expresses their concern and their care and their sorrow, then probably you should do something else.
Thank you all for being out there and bringing these stories back for us. Thank you for coming out this evening. I hope that you got some of your questions answered. We really appreciate your time tonight, and hope that it's been a great event for you.
Thank you.